Well, good morning, church family. Welcome to Heritage Bible Church's weekly worship service. We're glad you made it a priority today. Even though we're a little bit far apart, we're still together in spirit. Isn't it great that the same spirit that indwells you indwells me, and we can still have fellowship together? What a great God we have. And speaking of a great God, Psalm 100 invites us today that we should enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. I hope today as we sing the hymns together as a congregation that you will bless the Lord's name together as we worship the Lord this morning. We are here today to worship him, and this is our call to worship.
Gimel.
Deal bountifully with your servant, that I may live and keep your word. Open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law. I am a stranger in the earth. Do not hide your commandments from me. times. You rebuke the proud, the cursed, who stray from your commandments. Remove from me reproach and contempt, for I have kept your testimonies. Princes also sit and speak against me, but your servant meditates on your statutes. Your testimonies also are my delight and my counselors.
Good morning again. And you know, it's really interesting when you think about it. You can go on the internet and find almost any how-to video that you can imagine. I mean, you can do everything from small home repairs with how-to videos to learning a language if you wanted to do that, or how to plan a trip around the world or a trip to Europe. You can do almost anything. There's so many videos out there that are quote unquote how to. The interesting thing I found out when I did a little bit of research on this, I just mentioned the top videos of how to's, and believe it or not, this is what I found. Now, qualification, I don't know if this is scientific. I don't know if I just had a bad search engine. But here are the top five that I saw. Number five, how to style a woman's blazer in three different ways. I guess, ladies, if you're worried about that, that's one of the top videos out there on YouTube. Fourth, how to blow out curly hair so it's nice and straight. Again, I'm not worried about that, but there might be someone in the audience worried about that. How about this one? Number three, you might need this, right? How to escape quicksand. I'm not sure where there's any quicksand around here, but you never know when you might need that. How to escape quicksand. Number two, how to cook perfect pasta. Now, this could be helpful for me. Every now and then, I do get in the kitchen, and I do enjoy cooking. Give Kelly a break. And my experiments growing up in Cleveland, Ohio as a young kid, my experiments with trying to cook spaghetti turned out to be looking like tree trunks. And so that video may be helpful for me. I'll have to go back and look at that. And the number one video was how to fold a fitted sheet. How to fold a fitted sheet. And so, you know, those are your top videos. But then I did some nice research and tried to look at, what about prayer? What kind of videos are out there on how to pray or how to learn to pray or how do you pray? And this is what I found. I found 143 million videos. Now, I didn't count them all. Google has a counter up on the top. And so I couldn't believe it. 143 million videos just on the subject of prayer. What is prayer? How do you pray? What do you say? What do you do? What do you not do? Those kinds of things. You think, well, why is this so important today? Well, I can think of just a few reasons today as we think about how should we pray? And a couple of reasons why we should really study this subject is, historically, the disciples requested that the Lord should teach them how to pray, which we're going to find out in just a minute. Congregationally, this fulfills our mission, which, as you know, is to develop a passion for God and compassion for people as we cross the bridge over from Sagewood to Desert Willow and Acacia on our journey here at the Sagewood community. So historical, congregational, and then thirdly, experiential. I got to tell you, there's times in my personal life when I begin praying and I just kind of choke. I kind of forget what I'm saying. I kind of forget, like, how am I supposed to pray? And it doesn't happen often, but there are times when I just don't have much to say, or I don't know what to say. Maybe you're not that way, but I certainly have those times when it happens. Now, those are three good reasons, and we need to ask ourselves, how do we pray then? Well, thankfully, Jesus doesn't leave us in the dark. And thankfully, he doesn't tell us to tune in to one of the 143 million videos found on YouTube. Jesus gives us a personal lesson on what it means and how to pray. Now, we're all familiar with this. In the Gospel of Luke, here's the background setting. It happened that while Jesus was praying in a certain place, after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, just as John also taught his disciples." Before the Lord taught the disciples how to pray, we need to discover that he taught them what not to do when you pray. And that's the beautiful thing of what Jesus tells us. And this is where we're going to be going. I'm going to give us an outline that the Lord gives us. And oh, by the way, when we rehearse this disciples' prayer that the Lord gave to us, it not only teaches us how to pray, but if we do it correctly, it will also help us fulfill the very mission, vision of our church. In other words, this week we're going to talk about how to develop a passion for God using this prayer. Next week we'll talk about how to develop a compassion for people. So today, really focusing on developing a passion for God by using the Lord's Prayer that he gave to us, also known as the Disciples' Prayer. And the first thing he taught us, as I mentioned, is what not to do. And he says we need to reject false ways to access the Father. Notice what Jesus says in verse 5. My Bible's open to Matthew 6, verse 5. He says, "When you pray, you're not like to be the hypocrites, for they love to stand in prayer and in the synagogues and on the street corners so that they may be seen by men. Truly I say to you, they have the reward in full. So the first thing Jesus tells us to do, or not to do, is to be like the hypocrites. Now, these were the religious leaders who did two things. Number one, they loved praying in public to get attention. And they also loved, earlier in the chapter, they loved to let people know what they were giving financially so everyone could be impressed. Jesus says, don't be like the hypocrites. And a hypocrite, just by definition, is a person pretending to have a virtuous character, moral or religious belief that they really don't possess. They were trying to appear like a prayer warrior here, but really they were just looking for public recognition. See, the problem with hypocrites are they're using bad motives, and Jesus sees right through that. You know, hypocrites may fool some people some of the time, but you can't fool God anytime. And here's the sad thing. They're really fooling themselves when they pray this way. So he says, don't do that. Don't be like them at all. Don't try to imitate someone that you're not. Because that's hypocrisy too, right? Even if that person's a godly person, if I try to imitate how they pray, is that really genuine? No. I need to find a way to communicate to God in my own words. Now, we can learn principles from other people and we can learn methods that they do, but we cannot afford to use models that are hypocritic, that are hypocrisy. Excuse me. So he said, don't be like the Gentiles. And then verse 7, he says, don't be like the pagans. Now, the pagans, what they do is they use vain repetition. Look at verse 7. He says, and when you're praying, do not use meaningless repetition as the Gentiles do, for they suppose they'll be heard. See, the problem is they thought they would come up with their own words. They would come up with their own ways of praying to God. God doesn't hear just because we repeat the same thing over and over again. God hears us because of our heart. And because the pagans didn't have a relationship with God, God's not going to hear that prayer. There's nowhere in Scripture that it says God listens to the prayer of an unbeliever, except the prayer that says, Lord, forgive me, I'm a sinner. That's the prayer God hears from a non-believer. But if a non-believer doesn't have their heart right with God, God's not going to hear them. And the psalmist tells us, if I regard iniquity in my heart, God will not hear me. So I got to make sure that my heart is pure. So the first thing to do is reject false ways to the Father. Secondly, we need to reserve space for the Father. Look at verse 6 again. He says, but when you pray, go into your inner room, close your door. God is asking us to reserve space when we come to the Lord. Cut out everything else. That's exactly what that word means. Go into your inner room. It means to cut out. It was used of a storeroom in the first century, a place that most people didn't go to. Private. We're to keep it private. We are to keep it practical, and that is to reject any distraction outside of God the Father. Now, you try that just for 5 minutes. Try being silent before God for 5 minutes without having all kinds of distractions. Trust me, we need to reserve space for God when we learn how to pray. Thirdly, we need to refocus on our Father. Look at verse 6 again at the end of it. He says, and pray to your Father who's in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. See, the hypocrites had the reward when everyone was impressed with how they pray. Jesus is trying to help us gain rewards that only the Father can give us. And those rewards are manifold. It could be answered to prayer. It could be seeing someone come to know Christ. It could be seeing seeing the impossible being achieved, the inconceivable being seen, and the unbelievable to be believed. That's what God wants to do. That's the reward he wants to do in and through both you and me. Because God wants us to learn how to pray and pray effectively. each and every day to Him. And then He says, pray this way, our Father. So we need to refocus on our Father. And that comes because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And that relationship caused us to be born again, which put us in the family of God, put us in a right relationship with God the Father, and we are able and empowered and given the blessing and privilege of calling God our Father. Well, when we call upon the Lord, what's He say? He says, call on the Father who's in heaven. That's His position. In heaven, He's sovereign, just as He is sovereign here on earth. He is King of all creation. He's the Father in heaven. And that means His preeminence too. He has first place. No one usurps Him. No one tells Him what to do. We need to address Him as the sovereign King that He is. And thirdly, it says, hallowed be your name. Now, that phrase really is a, if you will, a euphemism for the name Yahweh, which is where we get the word Jehovah. Hallowed be Jehovah. So when Jesus is saying we need to pray to the Father, hallowed be your name, He's saying holy is the name of Yahweh. And we need to keep God's name holy. We can't drag it down in the mud. We cannot use it for our own means. We need to use it respectfully and reverently. And that's what Jesus is saying here. Speaking of names, when we call upon Jesus, when you pray, I want to encourage all of us to use the names of God. Let me give you, for instance, seeing that we're talking about Jehovah. It says Jehovah Jireh. You've heard that before from Genesis 22. The Lord is our provider. Or how about Jehovah Sali? And that's from Psalm 18:2. And it means the Lord is our rock, something secure, something we can hold on to. Or Jehovah Suri, which means the Lord our strength. So when we pray, it's good to reflect these names back to God and let Him know these names. Finally, not only reject the false ways to God, reserve space for the Father, refocus on our Father, but fourth, realign to the Father's plan. Notice what He says in verse 10, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. See, the goal and purpose of prayer is not only asking what we want, which we'll find out next week, but really and primarily, it is realigning my life to what the Father's plan is. Because let's face it, we live in a world that is me first, and dog eat dog, and that stuff contaminates us. It's hard not to let that stuff affect us. And prayer brings us back to the center where we go, you know what, Lord? I was forcing my will. I was forcing my desires. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, not only on earth as it is in heaven, but also in my heart and in my mind. So, Lord, let your program happen. And oh, by the way, God has a program for you and me. He has a program specifically for you and me. He has a place in this world that only you can occupy. And He wants you to understand that by praying for it. God, show me those things. So for the next couple minutes, what I want to do is practically walk through how we can use this prayer to develop a passion for God. Just for a moment, will you join me as we pray together, as we focus on these principles that we've learned? And the first principle, as we've said before, is to reserve space for the Father. Now I'm going to bypass the rejection of false things because I really want to focus on prayer. Reserve space for the Father. So let me show you something that I've learned over the course of time, and that is just to pause, to close my eyes, to slow things down, Pay attention to your breathing. If necessary, take a deep breath in and say, Father, I'm coming into your presence and I want to thank you for being my Father. Tell that to God right now. Ask him to reserve space in your heart and your mind for him by removing all the distractions that are there in your heart. Father, remove distractions, the things that so easily fill our minds and cause, Lord, us to think about something other than you. Remove those things that cause anxiety or worry, whether it's people or circumstances or things. Remove those things. And so when I'm quiet before the Lord like this and I begin to see him reserve space for himself, it's then I move to refocusing on him. So let me ask you to join me today and refocus on the Father. Refocus on the name Jehovah together. And Father, we do that. We ask you that your name would be hallowed in our hearts, in our minds. We pray that the name Yahweh, Jehovah God, would be honored in our hearts, in our lives. He is the one true God. He is our Savior and our Lord. Thank you for being our Jehovah, the Eternal One. So let me pause here and ask you, what do you need from God today? Do you need healing? His name is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals me. Do you need guidance today? The Lord's name is Jehovah Rohi, the Lord is my shepherd. Do you need peace in your heart? Maybe there's some circumstances that just have you really on edge. The name Jehovah Shalom. You know that word, Shalom. The Lord is my peace. Claim those names before the Lord today. Jehovah Rapha, my healer. Jehovah Rohi, my shepherd. Jehovah Shalom, my peace. What do you need from the Lord today? Pause and ask him right now. Wait for him. He will come. Jesus will come. Let's pause and ask him to do that. And Father, we ask you, as we pause, be our healer, our shepherd, our peace. Trust the Lord to come. He will meet you right here. And finally, realign ourselves to the Father's plan, which essentially, we go back to the text again. It says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. As I mentioned earlier, God has a place, a role for you, specifically that no one else can do. He's designed you perfectly for this. Ask him for that place, to show you what that place is, what that role is. But also ask him to show in his word the principles and the commands that he wants you to use to establish that role, to rule with him on earth, if you will, that his kingdom would live through you as he desires. See, God wants to do incredible things through you still. Not just to write out your days at Sagewood. He really wants you to rule in your circle of influence for his kingdom's sake. See, that's the key. The world wants to rule according to their kingdom's sake, right? God wants us to rule and establish his kingdom through his responsibilities that he gives to us, his word that he gives to us. Let me pray for that as we conclude. Father, we pray that your kingdom would come, that thy will would be done. Show us the roles that you want us to take on. Show us the responsibilities that go along with that. And we'll thank you, Lord. We'll thank you in Jesus' name. And Father, we just thank you for your word, for equipping us and for making us whole, for showing us the path of how to develop a passion for God today by, Lord, just refocusing our hearts on you, realigning our wills with you. And Lord, today we pray for those who are hurting, for those that are isolated. We pray for those who need to hear a word of encouragement from you, that through the music and the word and the scriptures and the teaching of your word, that they would find encouragement today for Jesus' sake. And let's all pray together the Lord's Prayer as he taught us, in accordance with what he has just taught us now today. We pray together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
See on the portals he
Well, I hope that you are finding a deeper passion for God in your heart today, as Jesus taught us how to develop that passion through this wonderful model prayer called the Lord's Prayer, the Disciples' Prayer, which leads right into our benediction from the great prophet Jeremiah. It is the Lord speaking to his people when he says this, and today I leave you with this wonderful benediction. Jeremiah writes, "The Lord says, I will listen to you. Call upon him today. Ask him to meet you right where you're at and develop your passion for God." God bless you. Have a wonderful week.